Ladies and gentlemen, join me as we welcome Abisade Adenubi.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. How's everyone doing today?
Awesome.
Good. So quick story. So when Pastor Uche called me to speak at today's event, I felt like it was a setup because the subject of the event is basically what God has been teaching me over the last few months by himself. However, I still wanted to hide. So I said, oh, why don't we? So she said, oh, you know, you will speak for like an hour. I said, an hour. I said, what about we do like a fireside chat so you can just ask me questions? That's easier, right, than like standing here and speaking. And so we agreed. She said, yes, great idea. Let's do that. And then God said, no, love. You will speak and I will tell you what to say. So here I am. Thank you very much, Pastor Mazes, for having me. Thank you very much, Pastor Uche, for having me. And it's a real honor and it's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I know you are here, here in your power. I know you are here. Precious Holy Spirit, I know you are here, here in your glory. I know you are here, precious Holy Spirit. I know you are here, flowing like a river. I know you are here, precious Holy Spirit. I know you are here, here to bring revival. I know you are here, precious Holy Spirit. I know you are here, blazing like a fire. I know you are here, precious Holy Spirit. I know you are here, here to take us higher. I know you are here, precious Holy Spirit. Spirit of God, we thank you for today. We ask that your hand will rest mightily over our hearts, over our souls, over our minds this morning, and we will hear only that which you want us to hear in Jesus' name. Amen. So I love that the Spirit of God is one because, you know, when God was basically telling me what to say today, I kept saying, this seems very spiritual. Like, there are also practical elements to riding the waves in business. But I thank God that Fred covered that very nicely. And I love that you ended on your last point, which was you must pray, because that's really what the Spirit of God has been leading me around in this season, that the underbelly of business is spiritual. We can do the business plans, we can have the right strategy, but the underbelly, the very, you know, at the very core and the center of business is spirituality, and we cannot lose sight of that. So I like to take walks. I enjoy taking walks by the ocean, and so very often I'll go and just walk and meditate and pray, or just walk. And so last week, Sunday, I did the same thing, and you know, I had it in mind that as I was walking on that day, I would just meditate on what God had been stirring in my heart. And as I was driving to park just by the ocean, there was a mighty wave, mighty, and I walk there all the time, and you very rarely see this. And I just smiled and said, God, this is how you used to do. So I parked my car, came, and I literally just stood in front of the waves and just watched for a while. And the first thing that dropped in my spirit was, to ride the waves, you must expect the wave. You cannot be taken, you cannot be caught unawares, you cannot be like, there's a wave, but you are in the ocean or by the ocean. If you don't want wave, then just stay by the stream
or in the river. And, you know, and what that means for me is if you want to do big things, if you want to be used mightily by God, you have to expect the waves. Otherwise, you can just choose a simple life by the stream, by the river, and just jaji I de go, jaji I de come. You go and you come every day, and, you know, there's no, you know, there are no waves. And that was the first thing that caught my eye, or that caught my attention. And it was really poignant for me. I just feel like God is just so magnificent in the way that he showed me a visual image, an experience of the topic of today, which is riding the wave. And in fact, as I was thinking about this again, I realized that, you know, even scripture says it, that in this life you will have many troubles. The Bible says in John 16:33 that I have told you these things so that in me you may have perfect peace. In the world, you will have tribulation and distress and suffering, but be courageous, be confident, be undaunted, be filled with hope and with joy, because I have overcome the world and my conquest is accomplished. So the first point for me was just really around understanding and accepting the fact that the waves will come and to expect them. Now, so I'm going to sort of talk about five different ideas around riding the waves. What can we do? What should we do? And the first thing is you must have a word. You must have a word from God to be able to ride the wave. You must be able to say, when things are difficult, when things are strange, everybody keeps saying, oh, we're in interesting times. When things are interesting, we must be able to say, but God told me this, but God showed me this, but God said this, you know. And whenever I think about the visionary journey and the visionary life, I think of the life of Joseph. And for Joseph, it was the dreams that God showed him. God showed him that he was going to rule over his family. For Abraham, it was the word that God gave him saying, look, I will make you a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and those who curse you, I will curse. And all the people on earth will be blessed through you. Those were the words that God gave Abraham, and those were the dreams that God showed Joseph. For me, I'll tell you a bit of my own story and where my own sort of dream happened. But three of the questions that I get asked most frequently are, one, how did you as a lawyer end up in manufacturing? I like to say I'm a factory worker. How did you end up being a factory worker? And the second question is, how did you, having lived everywhere in the world, end up in Abeokuta? You didn't even move back and live in Lagos. You went to the hinterlands of Abeokuta to, you know, to make your home there. And the third is, so I moved back to Nigeria in 2019, and everyone is like, when people are jackpying, how did you jackpada? How did you jackpada? Or how did you jabbo in this, you know, in these times? And the answer to all three questions is really the same. So a bit of a backstory. So I moved to England at the age of 17 for A-levels, ended up going to university, studying law, went to law school, etc. And then when it was time to start applying for jobs, I knew that I didn't really want to work in corporate because I just felt like it was selling your soul to, you know, to the corporate folk. People who work in corporate know you're like, they own you basically. I wanted to go and save the world and work for the United Nations, but they started telling you that to do that, you have to go and do an unpaid internship in the ICTY, International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia. I'm like, Yugoslavia? No. Let's not do that. we're not doing that. And at the same time, so my university was right in the center of London, and we were surrounded by the world's most renowned law firms and financial institutions, and we were heavily marketed. They toasted us badly. They would come and give us all kinds of things, take us to their offices, glass buildings with everything, gyms and, you know, all sorts. If you want a massage at work, you can get one, manicure, pedicure, everything was there. And that was the era of Ali McBeal. I don't know if anyone remembers that. So, you know, we would watch all these, like, you know, legal dramas. And I thought, this seems to be the life, you know. This seems to be the life. And besides, all my friends were going to work for Goldman Sachs and, you know, Magic Circle law firms. And it just seemed like the thing to do. So off I went. And I did this. And after 4 years, I began to get the itch, like, ugh, this doesn't quite feel like, you know, what I want to be doing. So I resigned. Now, just to put it in context, this firm that I resigned from is probably like top 5 law firm in the world. Everyone was like, are you mad? Are you crazy? Are they doing you in your village, or what's really going on? And so in that time out, I then sort of started, so a bit of more backstory. I'd always had an interest in the fashion industry. I have many family members who have been tailors and fashion designers, etc. And so anyways, I started this fashion brand. This was now 2011, thereabouts. And I did my first production in India. I had lived in Thailand for about 6 months, so I had a lot of tailor contacts. I did production in Thailand as well, and then in London. And it was one day, I think I was on a 13-hour flight from London to Bangkok in Thailand, and I began to think, and literally I would have left work, quickly left work, because I was still working, right? Quickly left work at whatever time, jumped on a plane, quickly went, jumped on a kada in Bangkok, like just market woman life, then, you know, quickly back to work. And I just thought, why can't I produce in Nigeria? We have tailors all over the place, right? So I then came to Nigeria to carry out research. We're now in 2014 to carry out research into garment production companies that could produce for us. Didn't really find any. And then I had the bright idea to like start something small. So I started a small production unit at home. But again, there were so many issues because the problem, Fred, you were saying in your talk that, you know, how do tailors make one sleeve shorter than the other? I can tell you for a whole day how it happens. How that comes about. There's a whole, you know, there's a whole manuscript that they use. But anyway, so I didn't really find any. So I started this thing and I realized we had like, I got people from like fashion schools that were training people. I couldn't even do basic things. So I realized that the issue was really the training. So anyway, at the same time, I began to think, okay, that if I was going to start producing in Nigeria, it wouldn't make sense to be importing fabric from Europe where I was buying fabric at the time. So I started carrying out research into textiles that I could use, African textiles that I could use. So I started traveling around West Africa, went to the Gambia, went to Ivory Coast, Ghana, and then I went to Abeokuta, which is where my factory is now. Funny story. So my mother is actually from Abeokuta. And my cousin is smiling because she has heard this story like 15 million times. But anyway, so my mom said, oh, let me come with you. I haven't actually been to Abeokuta in a while. So she came. And then my grandmother, my late grandmother, who was Ghanaian, said, ah, you people cannot leave me at home alone. I'm going to come. And this is important for what I'm going to say. So we all three generations entered the car and we went to Abeokuta. And we were headed somewhere. We were going to the market where they sell Adire fabric. On the way, my grandmother was the one who spotted a sign saying, Adire and African garments. And she said, oh, why don't we stop here? And I was like, oh, these old people. I was very reluctant. Eventually, you know, we stopped. And I got in there. We didn't find any Adire fabric, but what we found was an abandoned factory. They had literally sent all their staff home. They had closed down operations. And from the moment I saw that place, I said, this place belongs to me. This is December 2014. This place belongs to me. I could just see two things I really saw. One was the fact that I could solve the problem that I had been trying to solve for myself, which was production. And I could create jobs for many, many young people in Nigeria. And that's really still the mandate that I have today. It's really the fact that I want to produce garments where people would hold the garments that we produce next to what you have from China, and you can't tell the difference. Right, that's one. We don't need to be going to China to buy clothes, as far as I'm concerned, as a country of 200 million people. And the second thing is the textile and apparel industry is an industry that has the potential to create tons of jobs for young people, and I'm very interested in that. So that's still really what the mandate is today. And I mentioned this as sort of, you know, the sort of call that I had, because once I saw that image, once I saw the factory, it then took like another, I didn't take possession of the factory until 2019. And this was 2014. So it was 5 years later. Quick story. So the factory was owned by an ex-president of Nigeria. And so the problem now then became, how am I going to get in touch with him, right? It wasn't possible. You know how Nigerians are, they would say, ah, yes, I know somebody who knows his dog's sisters, whatever. But nothing came out of any of those proposals. So I carried myself back to England, and I decided that I was just going to go and do a master's in Switzerland. So I left my job, went to Geneva, and whilst I was there, I got a job for the Africa Progress Panel that was chaired by the late Kofi Annan. And long story short, they were shutting down the organization, and all the panel members had to come to our offices in Geneva. And the panel members were people like Strive Masiyiwa, Grasa Michelle, Tijani Tiam of Credit Suisse before, etc., and the owner of this garments factory. Can you believe? In fact, I have this thing that I said that God took me all the way to go and do masters for 2 years in Geneva for no reason, just to meet, just to meet the, you know, destiny partner, so to speak. So that was kind of how that happened. You know, a lot of things happened, and eventually, you know, I took hold of the factory or took possession of the factory in 2019. So that's kind of really what the call for me was. The second thing that I want to mention is about consecration. So I feel like after the call, everywhere in the Bible that we see when God calls someone is calamity and chaos that follows. Joseph got thrown into the pit, got sold into slavery, you know, or just all kinds of different things happened. Daniel and Co. got just all sorts of problems. And so for me, I feel like my own consecration is, for, you know, so for Joseph and God, I feel like during that consecration period, God calls us into separation as well. For Joseph, it was being separated from his family. For Abraham, it was, you know, leave your household, leave your father's house and go to a land that I would show you. And for me, after I had seen that factory in 2014, I went back to England, and then January 2015, I felt like God called me to a fast, a 40-day fast. So I said, okay, I was going to do this fast. Now, those of you who are very structured and plan and like to plan will understand what I'm about to say. So I was doing this fast, and I had planned it to the T. It had a title, In Pursuit of God's Glory and God's Purpose. Because I kept saying, I've moved around a lot. I just want to know what would God have me do, right? What is my calling? What am I supposed to be doing? So I titled it In Pursuit of God's Glory and Purpose. I had, you know, methodically written down all the scriptures I was going to read, all the messages I was going to listen to, all the prayers I was going to pray. Everything was so planned, and I'm sure God has the king. So you want me to show you my glory on your own terms, according to your own agenda? Okay, now let's be going. So I did that for maybe like 3 or 4 days. And then for 3 days, I was literally on the floor. I was alone. So it's not even as if I could have been doing drama for anybody to see. I felt like God just was literally dragging me on the floor like this. Like this thing, this your proclivity towards control through planning, you will leave it here, because where you are going, you cannot control anything, right? For where you are going, heaven has to be your own control room. You have to receive instructions and move. So all these are many, 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 many plans. We are going to end it here. It's going to die here today. And I didn't really understand what was going on. But I knew, you know when the Bible says, and Jacob wrestled with God. It literally was a physical wrestling. Because this thing is so deeply ingrained in me. Like you have to plan. And there's nothing wrong with planning. But planning according to God's will. Planning according to what God has told you. And what God own, you know, fancy life that you want to live. And so that happened, and that was the period of, again, consecration happens in different stages, but that was the beginning of the consecration, and that was the first thing that happened, and that was necessary, because if not for that, there's no way I would have navigated myself and landed in Abeokuta. There's no way. Nothing wrong with Abeokuta, because I have my family is from there, right? But there's just no way, because I just had so many things I could have been doing. In fact, when I told my mentor that about this Abeokuta plan, he was yelling at me over the phone, like, have you seen your CV? Do you not know that you can work anywhere? And they're still telling you, come today, come tomorrow, come today, come to meeting today, meeting tomorrow. What is this? He just couldn't understand. And so again, that's another point. Like, I heard someone say a while ago that when God called you, it wasn't a conference call. It's only you that knows. It's only you that heard. So there are people that would have your best interests at heart, but you're the one that has the vision. You're the one who God has spoken to. You're the one who has heard, and you're the one who carries the vision and carries the burden in your heart and in your belly. So there's that consecration piece as well. And the best thing out of all of this is that if that hadn't happened, like I said, I wouldn't have ended up in Abeokuta. I not only didn't end up in Abeokuta, but I was inside. Like where I was living in Abeokuta, if you just go to Abeokuta for the day, you cannot see that place. Because it was, I don't even know how I ended up there, but it was inside. I was sleeping on a mattress on the floor with a standing fan in my room because all my money was in the business. And it's interesting because in that period of I couldn't even see. I was just so happy to be doing what I had been called to do. It was when I was leaving after 4 months. I said, "Huh? This is where I lived for 4 months, sleeping on the floor, after moving back to Nigeria from Geneva. Imagine. God, imagine. You know, so even now, when things happen, I'm like, God, I didn't call myself here. Like, left to me, there are many, many other things I could be doing. So please try and show up for this, try and show up for this thing that you have given me to do. Do you know what I mean? You know, so that was basically that. And for me, the lesson there is that you must be yielded. You know, you cannot do God's work on your own agenda based on your own plans. You have to yield in a place of consecration, in a place of separation, in a place of prayer. And it's an ongoing process as well. As I was meditating on, you know, on the concept of consecration and how important that is in the visionary life and even in terms of riding the waves as well, I was reading the book of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. And it says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. And I feel like whenever we read that scripture, we focus on the sin part. Let's lay aside every sin. But what comes before is the weight. And there's so many weights. And as I was meditating, I was seeing that weights can come in many, many different forms. Weights can be people that God has not instructed you to carry along on your journey, aka Father Abraham, right? Exactly. So you can say Lot was a weight, perhaps, but anyway. But yeah, so it can come in the form of people that are not meant for your journey that you are still dragging along, and they weigh you down because every weight is causing heaviness. It's making your journey more difficult. It's making it more tedious. Weights can also be in the form of character flaws, laziness, gossiping, just things that are just not necessary for where you're going. Weights can also be in the form of habits, bad habits, heart issues, jealousy, envy, strife, bitterness, just things that weigh you down either in your spirit, in your soul, or in your body. Excess material stuff, accumulating things, buy many different things, and then all of these things just now then become almost a snare on you. Excess food can also be a weight. And think about it, like when you eat akpu and, you know, oha soup at 10 o'clock, there's no prayer you want to pray at midnight. It's just not going to happen. Like, even if you start, thank you, Father, that's the end. It's all over. So excess food can also be a weight. And I share this because I feel like God is really calling us to a place where, as business people, where we are light on our feet and we can really do the Father's business. On this food matter, as I was studying and just praying, I began to see that when the children of Israel left Israel and left Egypt and they were in the wilderness, God was, when God gave them manna for 40 years, it was manna in the morning and quail in the evening. Same thing when Elijah was being fed by ravens. It was bread and meat in the morning, bread and meat in the evening, chicken, not like 5 snacks, 3 meals. You know, and so there's a theme for me about just being light and just being able to move and being able to do, you know, what God. Time wasting can also be a weight. Social media, Netflix, all these different things. And I also believe that we all have, so they're the sins, they're the weights, but we all also have our own individual consecrations. They're things that God will have called you to do or not to do that he wouldn't necessarily call me to do or not to do. But for where you are going, for where I'm going, there's the tailor-made approach of what you need to do. For some people, it's like, you know, you might not eat certain things or you might not go to certain places, but it's really about finding out what is my own personal consecration, what is God really requiring of me in this visionary work. And I say all of that to say that these things, just knowing one's consecration, helps to ride the waves, because in those times where there are difficulties and where there are challenges, it's that consecration, those practices that you have developed, that you have instilled in yourself, that can carry you through the waves. The third point I want to make is power. You must wield power. You know, I think that a lot of us Christians don't have any power these days, really. Sometimes we don't have that authority. We don't have that might that we need to do a lot of the things that we want to do. Acts chapter 1 verse 8 says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And Acts 2 verse 1 says, "When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting." And as I read these two scriptures, you know, three things came out for me. One, the fact that when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you receive power. So to get power, you need the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit comes upon us when we pray individually, when we pray corporately. And thirdly, when we receive power, then it is only then that we can be witnesses in all of these different areas. And for us as business people, it's then that we can be witnesses in the specific arenas that God has called us to. And so I believe that God is really looking for undercover agents. Like I said at the beginning, the thing that God has been highlighting to me is that business is spiritual. And as business people who are Christian, we really need to understand that. And something that came to mind as I was preparing for this was the people on the other side, they understand this. They understand it so much more than we do. You have somebody who is going for a meeting and they've gone to their own power source. And they will tell them, no problem, you have this meeting, there's a lot at stake, no problem. At midnight, go to this Orita Mary. Orita Mary is four junction spots. There you put one calabash, two boiled eggs, the left eye of an owl, one red bandana, and God knows whatever else, and they will get it done. No matter how big this person is, they will do it. They will find the eye of an owl. And they'll do it. And they'll come up to that and they'll show up at that meeting. But we is in the morning. As you are getting ready. When they've fortified themselves already. And it's interesting because when I lived in Geneva, I would go to these like trade mission meetings. And certain countries that I would not mention, they would have collected per diem. And they would seize the opportunity to go shopping during the breaks. But the other people, they're forming alliances in those break times. And then when everybody now reconvenes, Japan will say, yeah, what France said, we're aligned. Turkey will say, yes, what these guys said. And then people will be like, what happened? What did they say? What did I miss? But they've shared everything already. When you were in Selfridges or when you were in wherever. Yes, when you were in Max and Spencer, everything has been concluded already. You will just appear, you will be lost. And that's how we often turn up to meetings. We just go just unprepared, no power, so casually, you know. And then we start wondering why things are happening in the way that they happen, you know. But we need that power, really, and we can only get that power from a place of prayer. I remember, I think it was maybe like 6 years ago, before I was started at the factory, I was feeling a leading to start praying in the middle of the night. And I was like, I'm not a pastor. Like, who did I offend that I'll be waking up Loru in the middle of the night to be, what am I praying for exactly? Only if I had known what was waiting for me in the front. Only if I had known. And so power is really important as we ride the waves. Because even as I was preparing for this, I was looking at surfers. When surfers are, and I'm going to play a video at the end. When surfers are surfing waves, they stand strong. You have to be sturdy. You have to be strong. You have to have power. Otherwise, you will just be blown away and swept away in the wave and in the winds. But I also think that a lot of times we know that we need that power. We know that we need to pray, but it's a cost. There's a cost to it, right? Because there would never be a convenient time to pray. There will never be. There's always something else that you could be doing. You could be watching Netflix on a Friday evening and just drinking a glass of wine, just living your best life, or you could be praying. So there's a cost. And also, the higher one goes in prayer, the more God calls you into a place of consecration and discipline. And we try and avoid that. We really do. Like when it says in Psalm 24, that who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. And so we know that to ascend into this place of prayer and utmost consecration, we have to have clean hands and a pure heart. And sometimes we want to dabble in things that are not clean and that are not pure. We want to compromise. We want to put one foot in and one foot out and just, you know, they go. But I think, and so we don't ascend because we know what it, you know, what is required to ascend. And so we stay in that comfortable place, and so we can't yield the kind of power that we should be able to yield. And so what God has been taking me through in this season has been that if you really want to do all of these things, if you want to be able to execute all of these things that I have put in your heart, you need to ascend. At whatever cost, you need to ascend. You need to come up higher. You need to come to a place where you can have, where you can enter a meeting and the other people are like, even they know that's power past power. They know that they've gone to give an owl or an owl's eye. But when they see you, they recognize that, there's another power in this. That's how we need to operate. You know, because otherwise we're not going to get anything done. We will just be, you know, floating around, running around in circles. But to really, because if you're trying to solve the world's wicked problems, the enemy's not going to sit around and just wait for you to create jobs for people, to remove people out of poverty, to take prostitutes off the streets, to take drug dealers off the roads, and all that. So it's a battle. And I feel like we haven't really come into a full understanding of what of the gravity and the weight of the battle that we're in. The fourth thing is you need to operate in discernment. We need to be able to see things. Like long ago, it's not now where we would think that it's only pastors and prophets that see. We all need to see. We all need to see because there are things that are hidden to the ordinary eye that we need to see to be able to operate in the levels that we want to operate. Some time ago in my business, a series of events played out. And as everything began to unravel, you know when Yorubas say, Oya Milenu, that means, it means I was surprised. But the literal meaning is it tore my mouth. Yeah? Like, as everything was happening, like as it was happening, my mouth was dropping lower and lower each time, like, eh? Or the English would say I was gobsmacked. That means like my mouth was slapped, basically, like just so shocking, just seeing people manifesting in different ways that I'd never expected. And I began to ask God, and that was really the beginning of this journey, and I began to ask God, like, what is going on? What is happening? Just tell me. And God began to show me things that I had not discerned, things that I had not seen. And I said, never again will I be blindsided. I cannot be, if something is happening in my business or going to happen, I must know. I must know in advance. Because it's not even just about me, but the people that God has put in my platoon, so to speak, I cannot mismanage their lives by not knowing. You know? And so it's just been really a real burden that I must see, I must hear, I must understand what God is saying. I must be able to discern. I must be able to see what's really going on. You know, and as I went on that journey, a few weeks after, something happened. So I had sent one of my staff to buy some machines in Lagos, and they had gone with an engineer to basically test to make sure that everything was working before they came, and they told me how much it was. I negotiated, and, you know, that was fine. And then one morning, the engineer... No, and then I called the engineer to say, this money is too much. We're trying to negotiate. Basically, he didn't agree. And I said, okay, that's fine. The next morning, he sent me these long messages on WhatsApp saying, Ma,
I'm really sorry. Please don't see me in a bad way. But basically, the staff, your staff who you sent to buy these machines had told me, and he sent me all the messages, had told me to inflate the price for you. But after we spoke yesterday, God told me to tell you. God told me that Abisade is my daughter. Call her and tell her all of these things. Can you believe? This is like a mechanic engineer in this Nigeria. In this very Nigeria. And he said, God told me to tell you that she's my daughter. You can't cheat her. And I felt like God was saying to me, hey, is this not how you want to be living? Do you not want to be seeing things? Do you not want things to be unfolded even when you're not there? Or you want to use your degree to be doing Aisabi passing? And God is like, let me send you go school. Calm down. You don't really know much. Do you understand? You don't really actually know that much. You actually don't, really. Because with all your education, could you have known this? You couldn't have known it. You know, and so God is like, just calm down and just walk with me. Which you choose you this day, or you can be doing in your own knowledge and not know what is going on, or you can, you know, or you can be hearing and seeing. And that's how I want to operate. I want to know things. I want to see things. I want, you know, I want to see secrets. And I love it how Daniel says it in the Bible when, you know, we know the story of Daniel. When he was interpreting, or he had interpreted the dreams of King Nebuchadnezzar. And I love it when he says, Daniel replied, no wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. I want to see mysteries. I want to see secrets. I want to know. I want to enter into meetings and know who is aligned with who, and who I should, you know, align with, or who, you know, what I should say. We just really need to operate in that supernatural realm. I feel like God has revealed himself to us as Father, as many different things, but he's calling us now to see the side of him that is the Lord of the angel armies, that is Yahweh Sabaoth, that is like, this is actually battle. We're here to take territory. We're here to make actual visible, tangible impact in the world. And we need discernment to be able to do that. We do. And the final point I'm going to make is patience and understanding times and seasons, which I think is also very important in terms of riding the waves. I feel like we're always in a hurry. We always want everything to be done now. We want everything to be now, but God is not in a hurry. He expects us to redeem the times, as we see in the Bible, but he's not in a hurry. There's nowhere in the Bible that says, Jesus quickly rushed to Peter's house and he just quickly dashed. Do you know what I mean? He didn't rush anywhere. Like, he moved with a sense of purpose and urgency, but he was not like, Jesus is quickly going to, you know, he was not like just quickly trying to do anything. You know, he knew his time. Even though he had come for the sole purpose of dying, he didn't even die quickly. He did not rush to die. You know, until the set time had come, but we want everything to be now. Shabi, when Joseph began to dream, he was 17. He didn't become governor of Egypt until he was 30 years old. When God gave Abraham the word that he gave him, he was 75. We did not see Isaac until he was 100 years old. You know, and so, but we're always, you know, in a hurry. A few months ago, I was in China for the first time, and I was just so blown away. I was so amazed. I was asking so many questions. One of the guys was like, are you from the government? All these your questions, there are plenty, and they're very governmental in nature. But I was just so curious and so amazed as to how a country had removed themselves from poverty in like 30 years. And I began to learn that they're so long range in their thinking. They're so, like, even, of course, being a manufacturer, I was very interested in how did you guys become the manufacturing capital of the world, you know? And I began to learn that way before they even started creating factories, they started creating roads, creating transport networks that would transport all of the goods that would eventually be manufactured in the factories. But we just want to do oshaprapra, like, now, just sharp, just quick. And God is like, calm down. You know, you need to understand. And I say this because when we're in the wave, sometimes we think, it's all over. Oh my God, everything is falling apart. But it's only a season. you know, and just really being able to understand the times and seasons that we're in is super key, because when you understand that, then you're better able to ride the wave, because you know that it's going to pass. It's going to pass. And there, you know, and God takes us through a different time. Sometimes he will keep you in hiding. He will cover you. Other times he will put you in a place of abundance. Other times he will put you in a place of consecration. Other times he will take you through a wilderness experience. But being able to understand all of those different seasons and to ride with those seasons is really critical. So yes, that's really, you know, so to kind of summarize, one is the call. You must be called. You must understand the call. You must know what God has said to you and what God has shown you. You must understand the consecration that is required to carry the weight of what God is asking you to do. You must operate and wield power, right? You must have a spirit of discernment and really seek discernment. Seek to understand and to know what God is saying in each season and to understand times and seasons. And I have a quick video to play before I finish, and I'll tell you why.
I can't live without surf. I can't live without surf.
My name is Antonio Loriano. I'm 18 years old. I'm a big wave rider from Nazareth. My father, he started surfing big waves like 2007. I was 5 years old, so I grew up in this world.
Tony's awesome. Love Tony. He's charging. He's been charging out here since he was 13.
He's one of the main guys out there from Portugal, and I'm very proud of him.
I wish him the best because he deserves it.
Surfing, it's a very mystical sport, and you have to deserve, you know, the waves that you surf.
The swell for tomorrow, I hope to be really big. I just want to catch like one of the biggest waves of my life.
Tomorrow looks to be insane.
Forecasted to be huge tomorrow.
Hopefully the biggest waves in the world.
There's definitely a lot of energy in the ocean.
Somebody might ride 100-foot wave. I mean, that's the rumor, right?
Tomorrow is gonna be amazing, I think.
It's gonna come in overnight. It'll peak probably 3 o'clock, but it should still be here in the morning. And it's gonna be big all day.
So, we are just watching the waves right now. It's really big. I think I never saw breaking so outside. So we are going to prepare everything to go to the water. Vamos lá esperar mais tempo.
Meu nome é Ramon Loriano, sou Big Wave Rescue e hoje vou fazer a segurança do meu filho Antônio Loriano. Hoje vamos trabalhar com muita segurança e muita cautela. Se não fizermos onda grande, mas pelo menos fazemos grandes ondas com segurança.
If someone is going to give his life for Antonio, it's the father. So that makes me feel more comfortable. I pray a lot.
Waves, when we're trying to ride waves, there's fear. There's a lot of fear. There's a scary, like it's big waves, things that we've never experienced before. It's scary. But I love that because Antonio's father and his mother said, if anybody is going to give his life to make sure his child is not swallowed up in these waves, it is his father. And we have a heavenly father who has given his son for us already. And so the message that I'm going to end on is, do not be afraid. Fear not. God will not mismanage your life. God will not cause you to stumble. God will lift you up in all that you do. He will cause you to stand firm in him, in Jesus' name. Amen.